Welcome everybody. My name is Peter Andrews. I'll be starting the session. Please continue eating as we speak. That's the whole idea. Keep your chewing down. So I'm based from London. I'm at the Royal National Throat, Nose and Ear Hospital, but I also am based at Queen Square, which is a neurosurgical centre, where I do anterior-scale-based surgery. I also have a real vision with regards to chronic rhinosinusitis and how to treat it earlier. Today we're going to be talking about XpreESS spoon balloon dilation under local anaesthetic in the ambulatory setting and how you get there. In a nutshell, we'll have various adoption pathways, starting from no one doing it at all to the ultimate pathway, which will be done and presented by Andy Wells, our colleague from America, where he does all his stuff under the local anaesthetic. So I'll start this process going. I've been affiliated with Stryker now for several years, and I'm a physician consultant with them. That's my declaration. My fellow presenters will be Andy Wells, who is a consultant rhinologist based in Augusta and has 10 years of experience using the XpreESS Stryker balloon. Raj Bala, who's my colleague from Manchester, also an experienced rhinologist, anterior skull based surgeon, also has a strong interest in chronic rhinosinusitis and also has a strong interest in how can we devise new pathways for the treatment of this disease process and take these patients out of the theatre and do them more in an ambulatory setting and the advantages. I will be focusing on NICE guidance, and this is a, like everything else, NICE is a governmental body which we have in the UK, which in essence gives the green light for any interventional process. So for any device to take place in the UK, it needs NICE guidance, which is it's a National Institute for Care and Excellence, and it's part of the Department of Health, and I'm sure in Europe you'll have similar bodies which we need to adhere to. The key with any NICE guidance is they only do it if your device can demonstrate advantages above what's currently in place. And we're always talking about how are balloons better than feds. Well, no one's saying they're better. What we're saying is that the evidence out there is showing that they're of equal efficiency and have equal results in a set group of patients. And these are patients who have early disease. How you define that is difficult. There isn't actually a definition for mild to moderate disease severity. But Raj will look at that, and also you look at the EPOS guidelines to help us through that process. What's interesting about the UK is that NICE guidance is important, because it's not just about giving the rubber stamp to a new device. It's about ensuring that your hospital facilitates it. So on one hand, you'll get NICE guidance saying XpreESS balloon dilation has the rubber stamp to go forwards, but it expects your hospital to put in place the infrastructure to enable it to happen. Now, in my hospital, I can only do it in an ambulatory setting because it's cost efficient. I save money for the trust by doing it under local. And this is the key, and this is what I want to get across to you today, how you adopt this sort of new philosophy. So balloon dilation came out in 2008, as we all know, and had its ups and downs with adoption. Lots of people criticised it, and also it has its positives. But we've moved on greatly from then. What NICE has done now is actually endorsed the XpreESS device, which is Stryker, and it's something I can only recommend because it's what I use and I've had great success with it. And Andy Wells will demonstrate how he does it in his practice. But in return, as well as endorsing it and as well as recommending it, what's beneficial for me is that I've now set up my own, what I call, minimally invasive surgical unit at my hospital. This has taken several years to put in place, but it's a unit which I can only do procedures under local anaesthetic, and this is where balloons come in. Of course, there's turbinate work, of course, there's polyp work, which can also be done under local. But local anaesthetic in Europe is a tricky thing. We come out in hives when we mention it. If you talk about local anaesthetic stroke sedation in the US, it's the general thing, it's what they do. Is it the way forward? Well, that's what we're here today to discuss. So So why did NICE, our governmental body, recommend this process? So in essence, and this is what I'll talk about over the next 5-10 minutes, is we as a group had to demonstrate that the outcomes using balloon under local were as good as the outcomes of FES under general anesthetic. And if you choose your right patients, the evidence is there. And I'll just go through some of the studies which show that. But what else is this philosophy endorsing? What it's challenging is the current NHS system we work in. I can't generalise throughout Europe, but within the UK, all our procedures are predominantly done with the GA, with massive waiting lists and massive cost associated with that. Now you as a clinician, if you can say to your local commissioners, well actually, I've come up with a separate pathway, which is quicker, it's done under local, people are streamlined, they get to their surgery faster, and then we touch on all about early surgical intervention in CRS. It's topical, and I'll go through some of the evidence which certainly endorses that. But fundamentally, with any adoption of a new device, it boils down to money. Is this cost effective? And the argument with balloons in the past under general anesthetic was always no, because the device itself costs too much, and then you have the GA on top. Whereas things have moved on. Now what we're saying is it is cost effective, because if you do it under local, you are saving yourself money, on average, £152 per patient. We'll talk about that in more detail. But this is why it was recommended by NICE, because it demonstrated both clinical and NHS advantages over current practice. And hopefully this will come across as we talk today. So for the patient, and this is what it's all about, how do you describe this technique to the patient? And we talk about minimally invasive, tissue sparing, it's done under local, and it's back to work within 2 days. Now these are sort of words you don't use when you talk about FES. When you talk about FES under general anesthetic, you talk about 2 weeks off work, there is tissue being removed, and yes, you will be going through hell and it won't be on your Christmas card list for 2 weeks. But FES has a massive role in CRS. I'm not saying it doesn't. But these are two separate care pathways, which I want to try to get across. The biggest hurdle we're finding, though, in the UK isn't so much about convincing patients this is the way forward, because it's all about choosing the right patient, but it's the biggest bottleneck is primary care in the UK. You know, noses aren't taken seriously. A lot of rhinology, unfortunately, is on what we call the hit list. It's not necessarily going to be funded in the future. So any pathway which can somehow excite your local commissioners is the way forward. And I think this is very optimistic, choosing this pathway. How you engage with GPs and patients is difficult, and that needs further work. Because really this journey of a different pathway needs to start in primary care. It doesn't need to start where we are, it needs to start in primary care. How we do that is tricky. So we talk about early intervention. We talk about the journey of refractory maximum medication. Raj Bala, my colleague, will talk about EPOS guidelines and go into this in more depth. But fundamentally, once medications reach its limit of treatment, this is when we see patients. The disease process becomes refractory, so we then offer them surgery after their 3 months of EPOS guideline medication. And we now know through Smith et al, Tim Smith and Bhattacharya that the surgical arm do a lot better than the continued medical arm. We know that. The problem though, and the problem we've always faced, and Bhattacharya described this in his paper, is that although the surgical arm does better, it's more of an expensive arm because of FES under general anesthetic. There's always an expense incurred, which opens up the other avenue of, let's think of a different pathway under local anesthetic. And this is his two arms when he described the study. This is very much the seminal paper which opened up this early intervention discussion. He published this in 2013 and he realised actually that A, the surgical arm does better than the continued medical arm, but more importantly what he showed in his paper is when he crossed over the people in the medical arm who were just fed up into the surgical arm, they never did as well. And this is when the debate about when do we operate, early or late, and it's still a debate. So this was also repeated with balloons. So with balloons, they're very keen to keep up, and they thought, well, okay, we'll devise a similar study, but use balloons, and they found equally that when you do balloons compared to continual medication, the balloon arm does better. And they also found that when you cross over from the medical to the surgical arm, they never do quite as well. As to why this happens, we don't know. So the seminal paper with regards to balloons under local anaesthetic is Chandra et al. This is the paper which has two components to it. The first component was at 1 year follow-up, and the second component was at 24 months. And it's a compelling paper. Now, their inclusion criteria was realistic, and it goes back to how do you grade CRS? You know, we don't really have a true definition of severity. You could argue there's grade 1, 2, and polyps. You could argue lots of things. I think Raj will look at this a bit more with the EPOS guidelines. But fundamentally, they decided that in their cohort of patients, they're going to focus on early disease. This is anterior ethmoid or maxillary disease. Anything more severe than that probably doesn't fall into balloon work. And this is what they found in this study. So in this study, what they showed, balloons on the local is just as good as Fez on the GA. And that's quite a powerful statement. These are UK, these are US patients. Whether this can be translated into the UK is a different subject. But fundamentally, what they're showing here is two things. It's just as effective, and also the results take you down the 24-month avenue where the outcomes are good. And this is the typical SNOT 20, SNOT 22 outcomes. In all the balloon studies, it's showing the same thing. They're all being reduced. And in that arm is a Fez under GA. So it's compelling, it's what they've shown, and this is what I'm putting across to you. Equally, they found following balloon intervention, the recurrence rates reduce as well. So for the UK, if I'm trying to sell this to my commissioners, I need to tell them how this is advantageous. You know, from what they can see is, hang on a second, an Express device costs £800, okay, it's less if you buy 10, you're going to do it under GA, hang on a minute, we're going to lose money. So for me to get over that, well, you know, actually no, we're devising a new pathway here. What we're going to do is go down the ambulatory pathway, which is rare in the UK, and it's quite rare in Europe. It's not rare in the States, and Andy Wells is going to talk about his experiences. But in the UK, there's only a few dedicated rhinology local anaesthetic units. And one of the advantages of moving my trust, which I'm currently in the process of doing, is that we could design these units and plan pathways along it. And as you can see from the slide, there's cost benefit from going down the local anaesthetic route. And there are hurdles. There are adoption drivers, which I've just described to you. These are all the advantages of doing it under local anaesthetic, but there are hurdles. And the biggest hurdle, actually, is becoming proficient with the device. And I certainly would not recommend to anyone in this audience to start doing this under local anaesthetic. You've got to go through a stage of learning, do it under GA first. Of course, that goes against everything I've just said, but you need to do at least 10, get a good feeling for it, and then you go down the stage process of doing it local in the theatre environment, and then the end stage is doing it local in a specifically designed unit. As I said, these are limited, and for me, the key though is if you are going to design a unit, make sure it has surgery in it, because it's all about tariffs. If you do this in outpatients in the UK, you'll be tariffed at £200 a case, and your commissioners won't, well, your hospital won't like it, so you've got to do it within a surgical unit, and we tend to come up with this minimally invasive surgical unit, where it is a theatre environment, and you can tariff at Fez rates. So the future for me really, and for my colleagues here, the future really is how do you start this separate ambulatory pathway? Do you start it in secondary care? Well, yes, that's where it starts. But really, you need to implant that seed into a patient early on in their journey. One of the papers we published quite recently is that I don't see patients at 6 months post onset of CRS, having had 3 months of maximum medication. I see 33% of my patients at 5 years, and it's quite extraordinary that in the UK, for some reason, patients just hang on to their disease process, and it's not treated earlier than you think, but that's just how it is. And a lot of the data, particularly Hopkins lung data, is showing similar end games in the UK. Patients aren't operated on until 2 to 3 years down the line. So how do we improve that? Well, that's a different talk altogether. The other problem we have is patient empowerment in the UK. Rhinology isn't taken seriously, unfortunately, by the patient. And therefore, they'll just go to their senior GP, they'll be given a spray, which I'll throw away in the car park as they walk out. And interestingly, a study by Philpott demonstrates this, that only 12% of patients with CRS take their medications, and only 1% douche their nose. It's quite extraordinary, really. The patients with a diagnosis of CRS don't actually take the medications. And this sums up the problem we have in the UK. How do you better empower patients as well as GPs? So I'm just going to come to an end here. And this is really my experience over the last 5 years, which is minimal. But I'm trying to get across to you that each of these five steps have been important to me. You've got to pick the right patient. And we often hear about how do you tell people about balloon dilation under local. You say it's like going to the dentist, and then they run out of the room as soon as you say that, and you bring them back in again, and you say, look, no, it's not as bad as going to the dentist, but, you know, it's the same philosophy. You know, it's about having a procedure under local, we work together, we'll chat, etc., etc. You've got to pick the right disease, of course you do. And we all know there are many phenotypes of CRS, and that's another subject altogether. But balloons are ideal for early stroke, mild to moderate disease processes. For me, what's made the difference is the XpreESS device. I can't say that more. It's an intuitive bit of kit. It's got a probe on the end, which you'd use like any ball probe in frontal sinus surgery. For me, it works. You need to think about how you're going to place this new pathway, and this is the third point, this minimally invasive surgical unit. I think this is something in the future for a lot of trust, so either develop your ownership over that. CT scan for me has been an important move forward, so I now appreciate the sagittals as well as the coronals, because you're always trying to map out how best to get into these areas. And post-operative care, that's a big thing. What you don't want to do is balloon under local and then come back with a lesion. So nasal port with steroids, post-operatively, game changer for me. And these 5 points for me have made all the difference for me to come to you and tell you about this. I wouldn't say it otherwise. It definitely works. It's a procedure though which needs practice, and this is where I hand over to my next speaker. Thank you.
Thank you. So great presentation.